Who are we here to see then tonight?
Is it Julian and Sandy round the hall? No, I like a bit round the hall.
Oh, round the hall's lovely.
See, we're so nice. I tell you what, look at this crap. They're so young. Look at
I
them.
Know. I thought we was here to see Tommy Trinder and his amazing flying crocodile.
I know. I thought we was here to see Jimmy Minger and his mechanised pigeons, but we don't get none of that.
I know. I tell you what, should we get ourselves a seat here?
I tell you, bad chap, lad. Who there are these two then?
I don't know. I think they're two men in trousers.
I tell you what, the one with the glasses looks like she's pre-op, I tell you.
Yes. I know. And the so-called blonde one looks like a bit of a gerbil,
oh,
doesn't she?
Yes. I tell you what, they don't make teeth like that those days.
No. Yeah.
Not many people here today, just the three of us together.
Oh, now they're starting. They're starting.
Oh, hang on.
Starting.
Starting.
Get off me girdle.
I'll tell you.
And now, fresh from a children's party in Byfleet, it's Mel and Sue!
Oh, thanks so much for just a minute for the sound effects of laughter there.
Hello there, and very good evening. I'm Mel, I'm blonde, irritatingly bubbly, unthreatening, 20/20 visioned, and straight.
Hello, I'm Sue, I'm a brunette, I'm very, very coruscating, deeply cynical, bespectacled, and straight. Away, let's get on with the show!
Now, you can't see us, so we've created some sound effects which adequately describe our faces. Here's me.
Here's me. Now, like all double acts, we're not friends.
No, we're a couple of failed actresses.
No, we've just come here, frankly, because it's free, because it's warm, and we like the snacks. And just for the sheer joy of having you all stare at us. Hello, sir.
Now, what people don't actually know is that we were originally put together by a management group, a bit like the band A1.
And like A1, we've gone nowhere, except for hitching.
But unlike the band A1, we will not be going.
Girl, I wanna tell you just how much I love you. Girl, I wanna tell you, you are my world.
And now this is the bit of the show that I love. Of course, we're contractually obliged to welcome some men. First up, a balding jazzer we found in a dumpling joint in the Ukraine, his sausagey fingers fumbling over his tiny organ. Our music man tonight, Bogdan Shevchenko.
And direct from the Thorndike Theatre, Leatherhead, where he's been box office administrator for the last 20 years, Paul Shahidi.
Hey! Thank you, thank you. It gives me great pleasure
all.
To be
here. Oh, Clytemnestra, my darling. Come and help Mummy onto her Stanner stairlift.
You interrupted me, Mother. I was devising a brave one-woman stage version of Zulu.
Now heave me up onto the Stanner, there's a love. Careful of Mummy's enema.
Now, which setting do you want, Mummy? Do you want Andante, Adagio, or Joyrider?
Andante, darling, Andante.
Okay, here we go. Oh, it's Joyrider, sorry.
Look at me, darling. Do I give good Stanner? I'm better than Ruddy Thora Heard. She cleans up all the work for the over-80s.
Probably because she's heaved her wrinkled Yorkshire thighs onto every director in the land, Mummy.
And she's northern. A regional accent always goes down well.
Yes, and so does she in nonagenarian yo-yo pants. Dirty little Thora. Oh, Mother, I think it's the postie. I shall open the door to him in the style of Anton Chekhov. Hello. You come from Moscow?
Oh, very good, darling. Yes, well, yes,
delivery for Dido and Clytemnestra Foxgrave. Is that you?
Is that me? Don't you recognize me, you witless urchin?
I am Dame Foxgrave, the voice of Banana Bickies, the most popular tea time snack from 1972 to 76.
And I am her daughter, Clytemnestra, star of television.
Sorry, you got me there.
Third slag from the right in the bill?
Nope.
Mottled corpse dragged from the riverbank in Casualty?
Nope. Sign here?
Sign. Sign. My first autograph.
Oh, well done, darling. Use the purple pen.
Ron's okay, says my mum. What is it?
Well, it's large.
It's brown. It's got weight to it. Could it possibly be?
A script!
So thick and,
Look. It's in colour.
Colour?
What is it? Is it a telly?
It is. Lakeland Catalogue. Oh. 200 pages. Ooh. Must be a series.
Oh, now, which parts are we up for?
Oh, it seems to be a very large cast. Oh, and there are photos of the cast. Kitchen cling film roller. Ooh. That would be you. Ooh. Apple corer. Vecpec clothes storer.
Sounds very sci-fi. Must be Stevie Spielberg.
Right. Shall I read some out?
Yes, my darling, do. But first, let's do some vocal warm-ups.
Feel better now? Good to moisten the orifices. I think I shall select the emotion of fear for this bit.
Oh, so brave, my little one.
Right, here we go. Storage is often a tricky issue with urban living.
Good, but believe
I shall try. So these plexiglass movable drawers on wheels come in handy.
Oh, this piece has such bravery, such nobility, such certainty.
Oh, Mummy, we shall be in this Lakeland catalogue. I shall play the part of the heated towel rheumatic.
And I shall play the self-assembly tool shred. Now, let's celebrate with a little sharpener. What time is it?
10 a.m.
Perfect.
Time for Thunderbird and Pineapple.
No, bring down the Benelin. We shall have Benelin spritzers to celebrate our forthcoming success in...
Lakey Lendy Catalogue.
There now follows a public service announcement.
Hey, kid, I'm the star of a failed sitcom. Now I'm wandering the streets in a brightly coloured suit, just pointing. Hey, little one, are you all right?
No, I've been wandering round the high street with my mum. Now I feel very out of breath.
Oh, you silly. Do you have a pain in your chest accompanied by a dizzying sensation?
Yeah.
Are you experiencing long blackouts?
Yeah.
Oh, you nutter. You've forgotten the golden rule. Hasn't she, Mum?
That's right.
It's easy. Breathe in, breathe out. Feeling better?
Much better, thank you.
Off you go, then. You see, it's easy to learn, Nippers. Breathe in, breathe out. Bebo.
Remember, kids, Bebo. It could save your life. And now, in association with the Task Force Against Chocolate and the Military Wing of the Lace Makers Guild, Radio 4 brings you its serialized adaptation of Jane Austen's lost novella, Sweet Fanny Adams.
Put that sample down. Oh, dear.
Sorry, Aunt. Mr. Weatherby brought it from London town.
Hush
and...
your prattle, prattle, child. Tidy your ringlets, lift your bonnet, and let me look under your hood. Oh, most excellent. Now, Harriet, I have news. Your cousin is coming to live with us.
Must I marry her, Aunt?
Oh, nonsense, child. Marry her? I never heard of such a thing. She has only 4 guineas a year. Of course you shall not marry her. Now, pass me that truss, some heavy lead-based makeup, and my waxy ring. Go greet her.
Hello, I'm Fanny.
Yes, I know you're Fanny. You're poor, you're from the countryside, and I don't like you.
Oh, thank you, Cuz. I'm so lucky to have such a kind and gentle and pretty relative to look after me. You see, I am an orphan. My mother and my father died in childbirth. I was sent to the poorhouse where I lost one of my lungs to consumption.
You sad little brunette. Come into the dining room and let me patronise you.
Cousin... How long must I sit in this cupboard? The croquet mallet has crushed my one good leg.
You shall stay there. I'm waiting here to get married. I shall be fine because I'm confident and beautiful and blonde and have £100 a year. But you plain little wretch, I imagine you shall stay there unloved forever.
But, can't you wait with me? It's very dark in here.
Are you complaining, you ungrateful waif?
No, I'm very grateful to be here and in the warm and with such a kind family.
Hush your incessant trappage. I have far too busy a schedule to listen to your whinings. Tonight I must sneer at the local spinsters, take the waters in Bath, then collapse in a fainting fit during a quadrille. Goodbye.
Girls, what are you doing?
Harriet, where to goodness is my Fanny?
She's locked herself in the cupboard out of spite.
Fanny, come here. My, how disgusting, disheveled, and unattractive you look.
You are indeed a vile little tragedy. Children, I have news from Lord Wetherby. His sons are due back from Paris, and we must visit them in London here much forthwithly.
A visit? To London?
Oh, we must faint immediately.
We shall leave immediately. Not you, Fanny. You shall clear the scullery and then walk all the way there.
Oh, thank you, kind uncle. Thank you.
And for heaven's sake, take that look of congenital ugliness off your face.
Hello, I'm Kirsty, but you can call me...
And I'm plain old Kirsty.
That's for sure.
Right, this is the news. The Dow Jones Index today... Look, I'm sorry, Kirsty, but that is really off-putting.
I have absolutely no idea what you're talking about.
You, sitting on the desk like that, your right buttock is completely masking my notes.
Well, I find it much more comfortable reading the news like this, with my legs akimbo and my heaving Hibernian bust sticking out. And I think it comes through in my voice.
Oh!
And now a roundup of the news read by me, Kirsty, in husky tones, my tongue playing lovingly around such words as Hezbollah. Sir, a hard, penetrating portion of news.
Yes, well, while some of us resort to showing an expanse of mottled thigh the size of Galashiels, even though we're on the radio, Kirsty, I will simply do what I do best.
Oh, shut your mouth, you self-satisfied chilly smuggins of Lothian frigid ear.
I would ask you to shut yours, Kirsty, but it's always left open, isn't it, in case the boss comes by. We all know what happens in the editing booth late at night. I've seen your dirty pants stuffed ignominiously under the chair of a morning.
At least my pants fold. How can you fold cast iron pants, Kirsty? I'm amazed your steel crotch girders get through security without setting the alarms off.
You're just a cheap Perthshire town bicycle, Kirsty, known for providing an exceptionally poor ride.
Well, at least someone wants to hop on my saddle, Kirsty.
Oh, shut it, you saggy-jowled mule.
Oh, well, not you wizened lard wagon.
Way-faced buffon buffoon.
Big-dugged news plum.
Cow-headed fluff vacuum.
Bob-hair-cutted gitwit.
Menstrual fallout merchant.
Brain turf and cherry popper.
Celebrity gobbling jockey nobbler.
Oh, you bingo-winged, goggle-eyed, trach-footed gusset grabber. I won.
No, I won.
No, I won.
I won.
I won.
We interrupt this catfight to bring you news just breaking. We're starting to get reports of a very disturbing scene occurring in the Weybridge area involving Sir Cliff Richard.
Grr, I'm so angry. Dash it all, I feel like throwing in the towel. And there it goes, my lavender-coloured tennis flannel. And there go my roller skates, my brush cap and flying suit. The guitar I never learned how to play. I merely strapped it around my neck and strummed myself witless. There go my Garfield slippers and rainbow leg warmers too. I'm so angry, I need help. I'm gonna have to blow. Who can help me?
Hello, Cliff. I've brought you some nice macaroons with fromage fray.
Delia Smith. In case that impression didn't make that entirely clear.
I'm relieved you did that. I sensed this impression was going to go right down the dumper, and indeed it has.
Did I mention that I was Sir Cliff Richard? Good. Delia, I've been through Hades itself. Luckily, the journey was made easier by the fact that I was wearing a leather waistcoat and some soft jazz trainers.
Perhaps I could fix you some homemade hummus.
I don't think hummus would help. The anger I felt, Delia, you've no idea. I've had to sit on my fists all day.
I do that sometimes, Cliff, as well.
It's a shame that's not televised, Delia, because that would make one hell of a program.
Yes.
Have you ever known anger?
Yes, Cliff. Sometimes when a souffle doesn't rise, but remains rather solid and eggy at the bottom, I feel myself getting really angry. I grasp my whisk, and that's when I know my self-respect's gone.
I'm just seeing red here, you know.
Is it a sort of orangey red?
Yeah, it's sort of like my eyeballs are bleeding, I don't know.
That'll be your Deirdre Barlow reactor-like glasses, Cliff.
Wow, you're right. I can see. And that's why Weybridge has looked so post-nuclear for the last decade.
Maybe I should fix you something heavy and spongy.
No, Delia. Being the pixie of pop, I have to maintain my helium weight and total absence of genitals. You said the word wee, Delia. Do you think you could see you and me as a wee thing?
If I'm honest, no, Cliff. I'd never date a man who tucks his shirt into his trousers.
But it looks so much neater like that. But hey, I can let my shirt tails hang out a bit, Delia.
Man.
Let's take off my padded bolero jacket and let's take off that rather restricted blouse. You look just great in those thermal jodhpurs, Delia. I feel positive about us, but having said that, I feel blandly positive about everything. Let's sing. Oh, Delia, my goddess, with anger I was huffing, till you came along and showed me new ways of stuffing.
Which came from my bestseller called Delia Summer, where I place some breadcrumbs into a turkey's bummer.
Which tastes like old man's socks. Delia, I'm 50. I wanna get nudie. Your heat-resistant jugs. Wow, they're making me feel broody.
Cliff, I have to say it. I like your tennis legs. They're almost as brilliant as the series I did on eggs.
Hallelujah! Sing together!
My meringues have turned to glue.
This can only mean one thing.
That's right, Sir Cliff. We're through.
Oh, Delia, I almost had a relationship there. Must an errant in my bachelor lifestyle?
Yes, Cliff. Although you're more than welcome to pop round for a blowtorch and a cup of sugar. When shall we reach London?
You are right, my pretty. You must be tired. We shall stop at the Little Chef at Box Hill for some delightful stewed chicken and plum pastries.
Not you, Fanny!
You are far too plump and plain to dine with us.
Sorry, Uncle, I cannot hear you. This here is Dropseed.
Isn't she horrid, Aunt? I do hope she'll stop her terrible temper when we reach London.
Mr. Weatherby, finally we meet.
Miss Prudence, we expected you months ago. The season is finished.
Well, we encountered terrible traffic at Grantchester. So many carriages. Plus, we had the burden of this terrible, grim little piece.
Why, she has the face of a battered hen. Come inside and meet my sons.
Not you, Fanny! You shall stay outside and comb the horses, whilst I dazzle wealthy bachelors with my charm and good looks.
Oh, thank you, Cuz. You really are the sweetest friend a girl could have.
Harriet, this is my youngest, William. He is handsome, bright, witty.
Excuse me, I must collapse into a coquettish heap.
Pick yourself up, child, you delicate flower. He is not for you. This is Edward, my eldest. He is a warty-faced vicar with gnarled hands and a stoop. He is the one.
And how many pounds does he have?
He shall inherit all of my £500.
Oh, what a handsome boy. Let us leave them both to stand uncomfortably by a fireplace and discuss marriage. Total strangers that they are.
But what of me, Cass?
You can stay there and be ignored, you disfigured little orphan.
Harriet, I am the Reverend Edward. I am severe, bookish, dry, and controlling, and you must marry me. In addition, I am ill.
Hooray! Is it the gout? Why, I'll help you about the place, and when you die prematurely, I shall inherit your 500 guineas.
Yes, my dear, and in the meantime, we will read scripture whilst I slowly erode your personality.
And now on Radio 4, as part of our Evensong broadcast, we go live to the choir of Durham Cathedral for Vespers.
The island of Leather, 3 miles west of Lundy in the Bristol Channel.
Exciting.
Population, 7. 5 tax exiles living in state-of-the-art million-pound bungalows, 1 retired policeman and a gestalt therapist.
Dangerous.
1 grocery, open from 12 till 3, selling fudge and pattern jumpers.
Cosmopolitan.
1 village idiot with wandering eye, big wonky teeth and feral musk.
Ridiculous.
1 pint-sized detective in a blouson leather jacket.
Sexy.
1 fun-sized antique dealer in a blouson leather jacket.
Erotic.
And when they got together, it was...
criminal.
Welcome to Leather Island.
Jim, what are you doing?
Just staring into a gale to maintain my weather-beaten golf bag of a face, Lovejoy.
Interesting. I like to buff mine with saddle soap. Brings out a ruddy shine on the jowls.
No time to discuss your skincare routine, Lovejoy. There's been a homicidal murder crime.
Anyone dead?
A resident lady, age between 18 and 72. My feeling is she was a slag.
Any suspects?
No, but I'm not ruling out the other 6 people who live here.
Where's the stiff, Jim?
On the other side of the island. Way over there. Just beyond that hillock. Just near where that starling is sitting on the branch.
Saunter over, shall we, Jim? Via that large-breasted female who's twice my height and would never look at me in real life.
No. Let's take the 6-litre Jaguar. It'll be quicker. Right. Here we are, the other side of the island.
That's the beauty of a car you've got there, Jim.
0 to 60 in 5 seconds. Of course, the island's only 5 meters square, so haven't been able to road test her as hard as I'd like. Lock the door, will you? Any number of 4 kleptomaniac billionaires could be waiting around to pinch this little baby.
Lovejoy! Jim! Great to see you!
Charlie!
How are you? I'm not really interested, of course, because you're a man, and I only like ladies. Jim, what are you doing?
Just squinting into the horizon to maintain that eye, like, chewed toffee look. God, I'm handsome and brooding. Charlie! Give me a firm, heterosexual handshake, and then keep your distance, man. How are you?
Exhausted from a 4-minute trek to this side of the island, Jim. So, here's the victim. Terrible, isn't it?
Well, when you see crime as much as I do on this island, you get used to it.
Pretty little lady. Do you think antiques were involved?
Possibly. The hatchet embedded in her face looks like it's from Sheffield, circa 1859.
Mm. Axe in face notwithstanding, she's still a honey. How do you think she died?
I'm not sure. But I think it might have been natural causes.
Right. Let's have a look at her. Queen Anne legs with an adequately padded seat.
No signs of wear and tear. Well, that lowered trim looks a little jagged. What do you reckon?
I think she was a French prostitute who came over to the island on the ferry and got mixed up in some heavy, crazy madness while over here.
No, I think she was a spy for the KGB, who was also a prostituting lady whore. I'm going to go back to the station and round up the usual suspects.
I'll leave this in your capables. Speckled N 730, jar of old hooky.
Take care, Charlie.
Bye, Charlie! Fancy taking a stroll over, Jim?
No, it's far too far. Come on, let's take the jag. Hop in. There you go.
By the way, who's that lovely lady with the brown and white complexion and dazzling fawn eyes?
It's a Jersey cow.
Still got udders, though, eh? Catch you later. See you, Jim.
Well, that just about literally wraps things up.
Good, excellent. So, you, Melanie, any,
yes.
any plans for after the show?
Hmm.
Obviously, I won't see you till the next one because we like to keep our relationship strictly professional. We're not friends.
We're not friends. No. Well, my limo will be waiting at the door. So, thank goodness.
Good.
It's been an exhausting evening,
sure,
actually.
Yeah.
Okay.
Minicab for Mel and Sue. Is that you too?
Finally, Melanie, my chauffeur. Hello.
Oh,
hello.
You must be from the Stretch Limo Company.
No, sweet cabs. I'm from Boss Cabs in Harlesdon.
No, I'm sorry. There's obviously been a mistake.
No, I'm definitely from Boss Cabs, employers to all those fleeing Eastern Europe. Currently based in the Harlesdon area.
Radio 4 actually promised us two limos.
Well, you flaps. I was instructed to come here to pick up Miss Merkin and Miss Gadzuki. You better hurry up, darlings, because I'm on a double yellow. You know what I'm saying? What are you doing here anyway? Some kind of mother's meeting, is it?
No, this is the Mel and Sue thing.
Oh, and what are you two doing on it?
We're Mel and Sue.
Ah, and what do you do on it then?
We perform in it and we write
yeah.
it.
And where are like the stars of it?
Oh,
yeah. I tell you what I love on the radio. He's so funny. That Alistair Cook geezer. And when he started talking about America...
Could you wait outside?
We'll come and find you outside in the Mercedes, right?
I'm in the burnt out Allegro. Orange one. Can't miss it. Passenger door completely blackened. Still works, though. I've been told to drop Miss Pertiness off in Hendon and then Miss Cledroid off anywhere on the North Circular. That right?
Yeah.
You've been listening to The Mel and Sue Thing, performed and written by Sue Perkins and Mel Gedroich. More importantly, it featured me, Paul Shahidi. Music provided by Bogdan Shevchenko and Miko Gedroich, and produced by Elizabeth Freestone. And now for some wrong things.
Harriet, where to goodness is my fanny?
Oh, she's locked herself in...
That was the thermometer testing the temperature of the audience. Fanny Tick. Jane Austen Cross.
Radio 4 brings you its serialized adaptation of Jane Austen. Jane Austen!
God, he's true. Now I know why he was so cheap.
I know. Yes, Cliff. No, that was Savas, wasn't it? Yes, Cliff. No, what was it?
It sounded the same thing.
Yes, Cliff.
Shall I do it sad?
Yes, Cliff.
Let's try tragedy tinge with alcoholism.
Yes, Cliff.
Yes, Cliff. In your own time, love, because this is about you.
His sons are due back from Paris, and we must visit them in London henceforth. Next week.
So that's another mistake.
Yeah, that's right.
I've been through Hades itself, Delia. Luckily, the journey was made easier by the fact that I was wearing a soft weather lace coat.
Leather waistcoat. Oh.
Should we start from my entrance?
I'd like to go from your entrance.
Sorry.
It's always good to start from Mel's entrance. Where you'd end up, I've no idea. Taxi.
And I'm Bernard Breslaw.
And what a show last week's was. Sue, do you remember there was that
happy times, Mel, but don't peek. Remember last time?
Okay.
15 minutes of raw comedy and 15 minutes of silence, to which I did my fascinating monologue.
Okay,
well, it was a good show. In fact, it was so good that Radio 4's answer phone was absolutely packed with messages.
Oh, hello. This is Mel. Melissa. Yes, Melissa, I'd just like to say that I think the Mel and Sue thing is feasibly the best thing I've ever, ever, ever heard.
Say that it should get another series of it, because
it was brilliant, particularly Mel. She's extraordinary and much better than the other one.
Hello there,
Sir, this is Aus, Brian, and God, our show's, their show's good, and I hope it runs and runs and runs, because it's the only work they've got. We'll have...
Mention me.
The brunette, she's much better than the other one and deserves her own series.
Hello, this is Paul. I'm the man in the Mel and Sue show. I'd just like to say that in all my years of performing, I've never had to work with a more talentless, conceited, unpleasant, moronic, self-obsessed bunch of...
We don't have to hear that one. Sorry, to get rid of that one. It was a great show last week. Great memories.
My post-show evening shaped up a little bit like this. Thank you. Tarquin, hi.
And this is how I rounded off my night.
It is time to explain the rather musky smell to our listeners. There are men present.
There are men here, the men here on stage. You put the Y in the Y chromosome.
Now, last week we had Bogdan as our music man. Well, sadly, it didn't work out.
His visa expire.
Absolutely.
So, this week on day release from Gwent Remand Centre, where he's serving a 3-year sentence for stalking Richard Stilgo, and actually he's currently wearing Richard's face. Please welcome Roland Purves.
And direct from the Lyceum Theatre, Edinburgh, after a sell-out run on cornettos, Britain's most promising usher, Paul Shahidi.
Such a tiring day, Mummy.
Yes, my darling. Let's switch on and see our fellow thespians.
Countdown.
Which talentless Hermes in Dictionary Corner?
Donald Sinden.
Heck,
Lackey.
Dreadful old queen. Worked with him in 74.
Call that an anecdote, you wizened old fruit. Who's that? Harold Vorderman. It's an anagram of Northern Slapper.
Television, just because she can add up.
I can add up. One from the bottom, yes, Carol. And that's how you got where you are today, you randy little monkey.
Turn over, darling. I can't abide the slackness.
What's this?
Documentary. Call that entertainment?
Not an accent or leg warmers in sight, just real life. Real life bereft of actors.
Makes me want to tear at my eyes and murder my firstborn.
Mommy.
Makes me want to whirl my arthritic fists in the air. Why must they breed? Documentary.
Come, please, carry on like this and you'll never get to stand by that filing cabinet in Holby City.
No, what would make Mummy better?
Tixalix and cranberry.
Yes.
I shall go to the drinks cabinet in the style of Tennessee Williams. I have always relied on the comfort of strangers.
Yes.
So brave.
Quality.
So brave.
Hello, you two. Only me.
Derek, why do you insist on coming here?
Because I'm your son and I live here.
And where's that ridiculous accent from?
Birmingham, where we live.
Birmingham! Block out the sight of him, Clytie. Derek, what is this strange garb? It's grey, it's woolly, it all matches.
It's a suit.
Oh, dear. No codpiece, no doublet and hose, no jazz pumps.
No large velvet throw, no loose rehearsal slacks.
People don't really wear that sort of stuff to work. I am an accountant.
Accountant? Work? You call 9 to 5 sitting in an office work?
Have you ever dressed as the monkey puzzle fairy?
Have you ever given of your Cleopatra to an audience of 3 in Shepton Mallet?
That's work,
that's
Derek.
Work. Yes,
no,
yes.
But I have been on television.
My son, Derek, on television. Brother Derek, on camera.
Yeah, we've got this new CCTV at work.
Oh,
Dame Dido Foxgrave, I'm arresting you on suspicion of shoplifting.
Oh, thank you.
You have the right to remain silent.
She doesn't want to remain silent. Do a speech, Mommy, do a speech.
Okay. Now I must see the video CCTV replay. How did I look?
The way you slip that bottle of Mirage into your cape. Such passion, such conviction. Oh, and that limp and inspired characterization.
I must see it. How did I look? Did the training show?
You were a star.
Come with me, madam. Take him down.
What? Cape and slacks.
Cheeky peeler.
There now follows a public service announcement.
I'm someone you recognise, but whose name escapes you. I'm loitering by a yellow crossing in a spandex suit, grinning like a hyena on smack. Hey, little one, are you all right?
No, I've been walking to the shops with my mum and I've got a pain in my tummy.
You ninny, are you feeling sick?
Yes, and I'm starting to turn yellow.
Feverish?
Yes.
You little goat, you've forgotten the golden rule, hasn't she, mum?
That's right.
It's easy to remember. Use your pancreas.
Feeling better? Much better, thank you.
Off you go, then.
I'm producing insulin.
Silly old Billy. You see, it's easy to remember. Use your pancreas. Ooh-yup.
Remember, kids, ooh-yup. It could save your life.
Tu veux ou tu veux pas? Tu veux, c'est bien. Si tu veux pas, tant pis.
So, Natty, Mimi, you're okay with the cleaning?
Yes.
And the feeding?
Yes.
She'll need her bottle quite soon, and if she gets bored, she likes her mobile, or try rocking her to sleep. Have a nice evening. Bye.
Au revoir, Monsieur Fletcher.
Salopard!
Connard. Monsieur Fletcher is very ugly. Boof, this job is very boring.
This England is very boring. It's caca merde, like it. Don't like it.
Mr. and Mrs. Fletcher are very boring.
The baby is very boring.
Yes.
She no speak, huh? She just go wah all the time. Ah!
Oh, no, she cried. She very bored.
I am not surprised. I also am very bored. I do not like this Peterborough.
Ah, Monsieur Fletcher, he says she likes the mobile. We try the mobile.
Okay.
Here, baby. Come here,
on,
baby.
Come on, baby.
Ah, quoi? Ah, salopard. Huh? Maybe we try the other one.
Okay.
We try the other one.
No.
No. Monsieur Fletcher, he says she likes to rock.
Okay, little baby, we rock her to sleep.
And now on Radio 4, Thought for the Day.
Hilarious,
wasn't it? And now, in association with the Michael Burke Jowl Federation, the Fatima Whitbread Depilation Unit, and the Peter Purvis Latex Personality Protector, BBC Radio 4 presents the latest instalment of Jane Austen's forgotten novella, Sweet Fanny Adams.
And so I, poor Fanny, an orphan from the country with a withered leg, club foot, half a consumptive lung and a dropsied ear, came to stay with my kind and gentle cousin London, dear reader.
Quiet, you slathering piece of nonsense, and my name isn't Reader, it's Harriet.
Sorry, cuz, I was just wondering when I could be let down from this chandelier, only my buckled limbs are starting to ail me.
Aunt, uncle, Fanny's making herself objectionable again.
Girls!
Harriet, my darling, my little angel, what has that pestilent wench done to you now?
She's frightful and horrid and smells of manure, and I've had to truss her and suspend her from the ceiling.
Well done, my darling. Ugh, the dribbling little simpleton. Fanny, hush your wittery gob-ramblings, else I shall birch your cheeks till they're as red as strawberries.
What a criminal grotesque! Why, she has the face like a chicken's rectory. What the dickens is to be done with her?
Uncle, who is Dickens?
Quiet with your witless panicking.
I hate her, Uncle. She's spoiled and horrid and from the country and poor.
She is a vile little upstart with the face of a betranced otter. Cut her down!
Ow, my shattered coccyx.
Now, my pretty blonde Harriet, I have news from Weatherby. He has arranged for a dance in Bath.
Oh, a dance?
We must faint immediately.
Ah.
We will
send word of our acceptance upon the instant.
Not you, Fanny.
You will saddle the horses, then bury yourself underground for the day, so we might not view your porcine brunetteness.
Messenger, away with this sealed acceptance. To Bath!
1 week later. Another week later. Another week later.
Excuse me, could I have a new horse, please?
Certainly, sir.
Six months and still no word from Bath. Oh, well, nothing for it.
Bath 147.
Witherby.
Prudence, we expected you in Bath 6 months ago. The season is over.
Then there is nothing for it. You must come to us.
Very well, I shall saddle the horses and come post haste to London.
1 week later. Another week later.
Do you have more horses?
No. But we have... Huskies.
Prudence, apologies for the delay. The huskies stopped for a granary bap at Julie's pantry.
Not a jot. Not a jot. Now let's all prepare for a dance.
Hurrah! I shall wear calico and muslin and ribbons and show my perfectly turned ankles and I will be loved and adored. Hooray! A dance.
Not you, Fanny.
Well, a light smattering of the old applause there for the Turkish entry here at Eurovision.
Next up on stage, we've got the Ukrainians, bless them.
Now, where in the name of Dana International is Ukraine, for Pete's sake? I've got no idea where it is.
It's something to do with the Russian.
Oh, well, what I can't understand with all these Ruskies is why they're such hypochondriacs. I mean, they get a simple cold and they go to war over it.
Have they not heard of the old hot lemon powder drink?
And here come the Ukrainians now. Apparently the following song is a woodcutter's lament. And I bet they lament the day they wore those horrible fur booties.
And I hope they'll be staying away from any naked flames with the old tassel jerkins there. Good to see four sturdy mustachioed Ukrainians there, Bogdan and Stanislav.
And of course the lovely Tatiana and Anna. Very luxuriant handlebars on the pair of them there. Let's hope they really get their teeth into tonight's performance.
If they had the teeth to do that. We understand they'll be performing the Kakalinka dance with their song.
And it certainly will be Kaka, if the rehearsal is anything to go by. Incidentally, I caught Tatiana eating coal before the show. Obviously a local dish there.
So here they are with... Now, God knows how I'm going to get the old tongue round this old title. Mazovzi Mazugi...
Do you not think when they made up that language they'd have made it easier to understand?
Absolute gibberish, isn't it? This is whatever it is. It's got music by Johnny Logan.
And lyrics by an old mucker of mine from the Lord's Taverners, Sir Tim Rice.
Mazovše mazurka vinovom, vladeniše kurva kevin, popitan strini banja banj, buljki plonk glorija hamilton. Maštjec bardzo kropopkin, viši skoki ti boju, knikarles.
The beetroot harvest is failing.
Drosni, drosni, ogran, babushka, shaga, teraz,
Grandfather has found solace with a donkey.
Zarodnie.
I feel so.
Zarodnie.
I feel so.
Prozak ni da bita blokarov tamazi panje valiomski. Liti om sin John Ward statiristiki ki poketi pošite si op.
Mift.
Mazoše mazurka vingavon, vladeniše kurva kevin, papita strigi banga bang, blinki plank gloria chani thord.
The turnip crop has blighted.
Babunya poli poli rinovsky.
Grandmother has gone looking for work at Spearmint Rhino.
Lindsay the poem, yes, Handy Shore, Donna Bucks, Fizz, Neil Chittle Baker, yes, Sloppery.
If I win the Eurovision, I will spend all my money on...
Dentist.
A gigolo.
Mazurka, mazurka, bing-a-bong, hey! Vladenische kurva, Kevin, Poppy downstream, Ragabai, Plinky Plunk, Gloria, ho!
Prudence, I have brought my family. Here are my sons, William and Edward. Edward, you remember Harriet. You are marrying her next month.
Yes, because I'm vivacious and pretty and blonde.
I care not for your beauty. I only care for writing dry satire that will one day end up on an A-level syllabus. Will you partake of a quadrille?
No, I'm far too pale and demure. You must ask Fanny. She will take a turn about the room.
Very well, although her feckless futterings fill me with a rare disgust. Fanny, will you dance?
Willingly, sir, if you will excuse my dowager's hump, hobbled feet and divergent eyes. Now, excuse me, I must faint with the shock of a man speaking to me.
And I will faint also.
Dance, Fanny, you impossible hoyden. Meanwhile, I shall openly plot your downfall with a man on the pianoforte.
Ah, my spirits are lifting.
Faster, sir. Faster.
Oh, I cannot keep a pace.
Faster yet, sir.
Oh, I am spent. I must enter a coma.
My God, Fanny has collapsed.
Oh, thank heavens. Is the truculent pug deceased?
One can only hope. Leave her spread-eagled. Come, gentlemen. We must withdraw to the billiard room for a glass of port, whereupon I will tell some blue and racist material about the colonies.
Women, let us retire to the drawing room while I shall discuss my husband's inadequacies in bed.
Fanny, I am William. Are you revived?
So, you were standing a bit too close to me.
Am I? Does it make you uncomfortable?
I am a woman and therefore cannot even finish my sentence.
Madam, do you wish to journey without?
Without what?
I mean, do you wish to take a turn about the rose gardens?
Well, I don't know. I am merely 45 years old, sir. I cannot be without chaperone.
I have syphilis.
Well, sir, I must contract it and then die a penniless, ugly orphan in a nameless grave.
Yes, Fanny.
Yes.
Ugh, this sightseeing is so boring.
Ugh. This London Eye, it is so slow. It buries the roller coasters are so much more fast.
Ugh, Big Ben. So it is a clock with a funny name.
So it go, ding, dong, ding. In France, we have much better clock. And it go, ding, 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 ding.
Big Ben is very ugly. It has a silly hat on top.
Ugh, I do not like Big Ben. It's very boring.
Westminster Cathedral, salopard.
Madame Tussaud, casse-toi.
Planetarium, fiche-moi le camp.
Roxacus, connard.
Natty, oui?
Burger King?
Burger King,
chouette! Burger King, chouette! I am going to walk along with my rucksack sticking out comme ça, so I can really bump into people. Should we walk side by side?
And then we can sit on the ground and sing you two songs.
Excellent!
Very, now, very do good. You mind?
Ha, chouette! Sunday,
please.
one microscopic island in the Bristol Channel.
Windswept.
A handful of residents worth a total of £25 million.
Jackpot.
One 24-hour post office cum mini-mart and a halal butcher.
Trotters.
Jim Bergerac, a chamois-faced detective in tight trousers.
Sunbeds.
Lovejoy, a 3-foot antique stealer.
Dwarfism.
A regular chain of highly solvable murders.
Mediocre.
And what do you have?
ITV1.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to Leather Island.
Bergerac!
Wow, you startled me, Lovejoy. I was just polishing my face. What do you think?
Jim, there's been a murder.
Was it fatal?
No, but it was deadly enough to kill someone.
Hmm. So, not a homicide then. Let me think about that whilst quizzically raising one of my sun-bleached eyebrows.
Good idea, Jim. And I'll take a time out to zip my pigeon chest back into this leather wind cheater.
So, where's the body?
Town centre. They found the little lady in a skip.
Well, no wonder she got into trouble. She shouldn't have been in that skip in the first place.
Let's head off before my attention gets diverted to that charming piece of skirt over there by the post office.
What? Walk it? Walk all the way to the town centre?
Well, it's only down the lane and first on the...
God gave me legs, Lovejoy, and I believe he gave me those legs so I could operate the pedals of a 6-litre Jaguar. No time to walk to the other side of the island. I've chartered a chopper. Hop in. Here we are, the other side of the island.
Keep your eyes peeled, Jim, for busty blondes with poor eyesight and low expectations.
Hello.
Willkommen, meinen sunbedded Herren.
Was machen Sie in Dresden, die Worte Lauthausen von Prostitution?
Du bist von Leather Island? Oh ja, wir müssen bangy bangy von dieser Gieße.
Grief, Lovejoy! We must have overshot Leather Island! This is Germany! Come on, let's head back!
Couldn't we stay? There's bound to be a murder that needs investigating. Plus, one of these pretty little Fraulein whores has got a rip in her stockings, and I feel in a darning mood!
Put that antique cane back in its holster and let's go back. Back on track. Let's find that corpse and then interview it. Get a few clues.
Bergerac, Lovejoy, great to see you. Thought you'd never get here. I walked here, took me nearly 5 minutes. I'm absolutely shattered.
Charlie! I'd love to embrace you, old friend, but my brittle sexuality prevents me. What's the deal?
Some silly old bird's gone and got herself dead. Look!
Dear, oh dear, that mottled blue lipstick isn't doing her any favours.
And that white gothic foundation really isn't her shade.
She was found stabbed in the back.
Looks like a suicide to me.
Boyfriend probably dumped her, then she got a little bit hysterical, you know.
Sad, Jim. Very sad.
Yeah. Still, she was only a brunette.
Exactly. Say, who's that round little slut with a gaping red mouth over there?
That's a postbox, Lovejoy.
Still, it's not going anywhere, is it? Now, my parking's up in 5 minutes in the local NCP, so it's really time to wrap things up. Goodbye, good evening, good night.
Thanks very much. I'd like to take this opportunity to invite the front row only back to my little love nest in Cheam.
Come for Miss Pumpkins and Miss Gutrot! Pumpkins and Gutrot!
Oh, dear. Hello to you again.
Hello, my little watermelons. Fate in the form of Brian, my controller, has brought us together again. I'm parked outside the white Mercedes.
Fantastic.
I'm next to it. Terracotta Bedford van. It's got a waterbed.
There is no way I'm going home in that.
Like you didn't go home last week, eh?
What's he talking about?
Listen, you. We are Radio 4 A-list celebs.
Yes, we're on A-list. Well, it's sort of more of a rotary. Really. I get to clean Libby Purvis's B-day. That means that sometimes
listen,
to...
Pupkins, relax. You are like a dry shank of lamb. Perhaps I'll let my hand slip on the gear for you.
Please.
Listen, my garlicky lady's fingers. You come outside. I see you in my bed. Ford. Wanna ride
up front again, little gut rot, like last time?
Yeah, we'll be right with you. Thank you very much. Just want to have a few words alone with my comedy partner. A few words like supper and you and R.
No time, goodbye. See you next week, taxi!
Listening to The Mel and Sue Thing, written, designed and starring Sue Perkins. The animals were handled by Mel Gedroyt. I'm Paul Shahidi, I was in it too. Music was by Roland Purves and Miko Gedroyt. The show was produced by Elizabeth Freestone.
And now for some wrong things.
You think it's easy standing here with a microphone reading? It's very, very complicated. 10 on 12. Line 10 on page 12.
Yes.
Don't demystify the process, Sue.
Bath 1471.
Stuttery. 1471? I dialed 1471 to find that 1471 was calling me.
Bath 147.
Is that James Mason?
Yes, it is.
No. That's actually superfluous to what we needed.
That was really supportive.
If you listened to what we were doing there, you'd realise that applause was not necessary. Just a terse silence. There's a strange problem with the microphone. Whenever I open my mouth, nothing funny comes out. Technical problem.
Have I got a moustache of sweat building? Just feel it. Just feel it coming.
I've got full chops.
Shouldn't have worn the sweater. Shouldn't have worn the sweater.
Was it fatal?
No. But it was... No, that's John Noakes.
John Noakes, love.
Let me, John.
No, you've turned into John. I'll be your vow, love.
So we were gliding round and I was just polishing my face.
I've just come off my bobsleigh gym.
Oh.
In my tracksuit.
Oh, I do hope they put that bit in pick of the week.
Ship flipping burgers at the Wacky Warehouse in Portsmouth. It's Mel and Sue!
Oh, saucy.
You overwhelm us.
Hello, I'm Rula Lenska.
And I'm Judge Pickles.
Now, I thought it'd be rather amusing, in a slightly cruel way, to set young Susan here a physical challenge.
Don't make me wear the mask again. Please don't make me wear the mask again. I don't like leather.
I challenge you, Susan Perkins, along with the cast of Lord of the Dance, headed by Michael Flatley himself, to dance on dangerous ground.
Hello.
Hello, Michael. The time you spent in England certainly has moderated your accent.
Susan, here are your clackety-clack shoes.
Okay, put those on.
Let the Lord of the Dance challenge commence.
Okay. Oh, it's going quite well, actually. I surprised myself. I should pour some petrol on the feet of Michael Flatley now and see if he really does have feet of flames. But now it's time to introduce some talent fresh from riotous applause at the Great Britain Clapping Championships, our musical mediocrity du jour, Brian Clutterbuck. Oh.
And now a face very well known to all those at the BBC. That's the Billericay Business College, Mr. Paul Shahidi. Hey!
So marvellous to be at the house of our dear fellow thespian Prunella Scales.
And her lovely husband, Timmy West. He was so commanding in that pet insurance advert.
Oh, and so large.
Face like a bag of hammers, such a treasured friend.
Wonderful family.
Wonderful house. Mm. Not that we've been let in, but looks like it from the outside. Right, Mummy, let's get you up the ladder. Have a goggle. Wait. Now, Mammy, I should warn you. I am downstage of you.
Yes.
My face is flush up against your fleshy duologues.
Reminds me of when we performed that brave two-hander together.
Dorbin the Mule. Froome Community Centre. You were the front two legs. I brought up the rear.
Such a daring performance.
Such an asphyxiating one. Now, no funny business, Mammy.
I'll try not to, but I did have that tzatziki before I
left. No, not the Middle Eastern buffet. Such resonance, such depth. Only 2 minutes in, a fart gas. Such intelligence and wit.
Sad, isn't it?
Oh, right, here we are, up the ladder. Oh, let's see what's going on at Prue and Timmy's lovely soiree. such lovely, hammy, chummy drinkies.
Oh, close friends, snacks and toddy. All the great and good are there.
And Bella Emberg. Her head a gobbler in Stratford was an absolute disgrace.
Is that Glenda Jackson over there? Still got the same wooden teeth as when she played Elizabeth I.
Thames in Earthwaite.
Golden handcuff deal with the BBC, my foot.
Yes, I'd like to golden handcuff her to a radiator and wait till her knockers drop. Bet the work and dry up then, Tammy.
I need a closer look. Pass me the opera glasses.
Yes, indeed, Mummy. I shall pass you the opera glasses in the style of famed choreographer Arlene Phillips.
No, no, darling. Not what physical jerks
no,
on the
no,
ladder.
No, no. Mummy, I'm blind. Mother, your turban has slipped over your eyes.
Oh, I can see. But I am dead.
No! Oh, she is dead. I shall grieve for my mother in the style of Ray Cooney. Dead. How stiff.
I'm alive!
Matron, yes,
suddenly!
Thank God for that. Let's have a night nurse and tonic to celebrate. Lovely, lovely drinkies. Who's this?
Chunky calves.
Rhythmical plodding in sensible shoes.
The bill, yes. I knew we'd get the call someday.
I'm arresting you for breaking and entering.
Oh, that'll mean an interrogation scene.
Feast.
There now follows a public service announcement.
Hey, kids, I'm someone who released a novelty Christmas single with Keith Harris and Cuddles the Monkey. Now I'm a washed-up one-hit wonder in a yellow plastic vest, patronising children at street crossings in the vain hope I get one more shot at the big time. Hey, kid, what's wrong?
I've got a splitting headache.
You blundering little plum. Are salt tears coursing down your cheeks?
Yeah.
Do you find that your vision is blurred?
Yeah.
You burkish young oaf. She's forgotten the golden rule, hasn't she, Mum?
That's right.
Remember, kid. You gotta remember, kid. Blink now and then. Be Nat. Yeah? Feeling better?
Yeah, much better, thanks.
Off you go, then. Now, don't be cocky, kids. Don't think you know it all. Remember, be Nat.
Be Nat. Tell your children. It could save their life.
And now on Radio 4, as part of our exclusive serialisation, we bring you Lord David Attenborough and Blue Planet.
Well, here we are on the Antarctic wastes, and it really is f***ing cold out here. And if we look closely, my testicles are, yes, practically f***ing falling off. Oh, look, a pair of tits flying south for the winter.
Hello, you are through to multi-screen cinemas. Please listen to the following choices and make your selection by pressing the star key on your touch-tone phone. On screen one.
The Bourne Identity.
Screen two.
My Big Fat Greek Wedding.
Screen three.
E2, Mama Tambien.
Screen four.
The Road to Perdition.
Screen five.
Once Upon a Time in the Midlands.
Screen six.
Simon Groom in Action Slacks 5.
You have selected...
Simon Groom in Action Slacks 5.
Which is weird. I'd have put you more down as an...
E2, Mama Tambien.
...person. The fact you've chosen...
Simon Groom in Action Slacks 5.
Instead of...
E2, Mama Tambien.
...makes you a laughing stock. Who wants to see that? Do you?
No.
Do you?
Maybe.
And you, what about you? What do you want to see?
E2, Mama Tambien.
We've only sold tickets for...
Simon Groom in Action Slacks 5.
And the auditorium seats...
600.
People. You do know it is showing at the...
Saturday Kids Club.
Don't you? So you will be wanting to purchase at least...
two.
...tickets, I suppose. One for you and one for the child who actually wants to see the film. You have selected...
one.
...ticket. One ticket. Please select what you are from the one of the following options. One.
Knobby nomates.
Two.
You have arrested development like me.
Three.
E2, Mama Champion. Sorry, an obsessive Simon Groom fan.
Please hold the line while we laugh at you.
And now, in association with the Joan Collins thigh painting tent and the Jim Davidson breast farm, Radio 4 is proud to bring you another episode of Jane Austen's lost novella, Sweet Fanny Adams.
And so I, Fanny, whose parents both died in childbirth, was sent to the poorhouse, whereupon a plague of cholera set to destroying all my fellow orphans. I was then sent to a governess, who took with the ague and passed away at Michaelmas. Thence I lodged with my grandfather, who took sick with consumption, whereupon I lost my teeth, withered my legs, and coughed up half my lungs. It was thus I got my name, Lucky Fanny. I now lodge with my kind aunt and uncle and my sweetest cousin Harriet.
Cease, you insipid dance, else I shall set the dogs on you.
Might I unhang myself from this wall, cousin?
No, you terse little upstart. You will stay thrust like a turkey till All Hallows Eve.
Why, thank you, my darling and kind and pretty
aunt, lovely... uncle, Fanny is filling the silence with her witless chatterings again.
What is this fearful ding-a-ling? Harriet, my poor creature, come nestle in my swollen guts.
Fanny, hush your insipid twatterings. Your indefatigable oofness is giving me the most pertinent of glandular uprisings.
Fanny has bound herself to the dado rail with chicken wire, aunt, and she's been shouting like a bedlamite.
Then we must bring her down and punish her.
Oh, my ruptured colon.
Now, come, my fair-haired favourite, and leave this raven-haired blobblemite to her futile weatherage. We must meet Edward.
Who is Edward?
Why, he is to be your husband. You exchanged a brief sentence with him last season.
He is a helotoid, limping, gouty wreck who wishes to join the priesthood and lecture in Bath.
How many pounds does he have?
£500?
Hurrah! Then I care not whether his nethers are warty. I shall be rich, as well as young and extremely pretty.
Very well. Let us saddle the horses and away.
Should Fanny not journey with us?
You kindly soul. Of course she shall. Fanny, you feckless little slapperbap, put on the reins. You shall be bridled and pull our carriage to the county. Here, take these coconut shells and rub them together. As you run, they will create a most pleasant illusion of horse travel.
Come, Fanny, you filthy mountebank! Run till your shanks are sweaty!
I shall, my most kind, hospitable, kind uncle, but this horse only has three legs and can only work in triplets.
She's uncivil and and slow, and I hate her, and she's rubbish on those coconuts. I shall prompt her to greater speed. Ow! Ow.
Come, you slatternly sallow cheek. Ride us to Knutsford!
Indeed, whereupon we shall enjoy a Burger King at the services. Yes.
Aunt, why has Fanny stopped?
Ugh, she is a most shriveled and pestilent futter snatch. Fanny, you dispiriting little mortification, what is the trouble?
The vile monkey cannot speak.
My calico slippers have worn right through.
Then we must stop at the blacksmith's to get her reshoed.
And perhaps we might have her branded there.
Good thinking, my little darling. Let us hot poker her palsied forearms.
Ow, my smoking rump. I must faint immediately. How boring. Fanny has died.
Fanny, you naughty little pig's bladder. Cease your corpsification immediately.
What is this nonsensical malingerance?
I've got chills. They're multiplying.
Are you losing control?
She's supplying.
It's electrifying.
Yes.
Shall I put her down? I have the blunderbuss.
Oh, leave her there. We shall take this mini carriage. Sir, to Box Hill.
Sorry, love, I don't go south of the river at this time of night.
There now follows a discussion about Sweet Fanny Adams by Professor Marsha Rosenberg and Barsha Kozlowska. M.Phil, Ph.D., H.G.V., lecturers in post-feminist literature at the New University of Leatherhead.
I really like the fact that Austin deftly represents the epiphonic divide between the phylogenetic cockocratic id and the more nascent, gynocentrically coded hermeneutic suggestion of the superego.
I like the joke about genital warts.
A story?
Why, sure, little cup. I'm going to tell you, little cup, about a story. It took place a long, long time ago. It was a dark time, full of pedal pushers and batwing jumpers and Kajagoogoo.
Mama, who's Kajagoogoo?
Oh, exactly.
Little cup, it was the 1980s. Gather round, children, hear a story. This is about a Chilean dictator and Maggie the Tory. Augusto, my heaving busto, is filled with great British pride. Give a hooray for Pinochet and me, his mad pig dog bride.
Thatcher, my milk snatcher, my perfect steely Margot, I want to show you my arsenal of weapons in San Diego.
Huge is blue, the future is bright, the future is here, and it's far right.
Don't worry, my bouffant sweetheart, we'll win through with guile.
I'll make some calls to the White House, and so you'll never stand trial.
We've many friends to help us. Phil Collins is always there.
And darling Andrew Lloyd Webber, and our successor, Tony Blair.
Good night, England.
The effect that laborious satire about the 1980s has, little one.
From the makers of Four Society Weddings and a Heart Attack, and Isn't Notting Hill Expensive Nowadays? Tweed Films presents Gosh, I'm Posh, starring Hugh Grant.
Nightmare. Yeah, I suppose that, yeah, I am very, very posh.
And Andy McDowell.
I'm just a girl with large gums and hair like Prince Charles. And I'm standing in front of a boy and I'm trying to tell him that I really, really want to sleep with him.
Featuring Elizabeth, you make me wanna Hurley.
Do you believe it's absolutely brilliant? I mean, really, really pushing the best film, the kind of a Damien, really good and same thing, and it's a nightmare.
And a whole cast of braying Sloanes. And as a special treat, with an hilarious regional accent, Ifan Rhys Llanelli.
Well, see, I'm hilarious. Because I'm from Wales. See?
With soundtrack by Dollar, Five Star, Pam Ayers, and Ronan Keating. Gosh, I'm posh. It'll make you laugh. It'll make you weep. It'll make you wish you were German.
Make your selection of program times for the film.
Simon Groom in Action Slacks 5.
Which I still can't quite believe you've chosen. I mean, if you'd chosen...
E2, Mama Tambien!
I'd have had more respect for you. That's a Spanish story about two college friends who pick up an...
older woman.
And it's a coming of age...
sexual room.
While...
Simon Groom in Action Slacks 5.
Features Simon Groom in a kid's thriller in which he has a...
magical pair of trousers which can defeat evil.
Whilst waiting for your tickets to process, please select a tune from the following options by pressing the hash key. Would you like... 1.
Handel's Water Music.
2.
Body Talk by Imagination.
3.
If you want my body and you think I'm sexy.
You have selected...
if you want my body and you think I'm sexy.
While you're waiting for the processing of your tickets for...
Simon Groom in Action Slacks 5.
And the...
Saturday Kids Club.
Which you're attending very much...
on your own.
Please hold the line while we discuss how to further humiliate you.
And now on the BBC, Walking with Dinosaurs.
Right, Velociraptors, if you could just remember the country code, you see this green mark indicates the start of the Pennine Way.
So, if you could follow us, and can I remind all of you to shut the gates behind you?
Hello, I'm Simon Groom. Thanks for phoning this multi-screen phone line for your booking of...
1.
Ticket to see my film...
Action Slacks 5.
Starring me...
Simon Groom.
And co-starring the lovely...
Keith O'Mara.
I get the kid's gate in the film...
Action Slacks 5.
Which was a bit like immersing my head into a...
pile of dead leaves.
Since you are the...
1.
...person to have purchased a ticket, maybe we could meet up for a...
drink.
Or...
hot beverage.
After the show. Cheerio, then. And see you at the screening of my film...
Action Slacks 5.
E2, Mama Champion!
A £10 booking fee has been charged to your card. Thanks for phoning.
The smallest island in Europe.
Subsiding.
A handful of residents getting slaughtered week by week.
Careless.
One falafel stand, one trainee reflexologist, and a Corby trouser museum.
Tourism.
Jim Bergerac, a detective in chafing brine nylon slacks.
Thrush.
Lovejoy, an antiques dealer with built-up shoes.
Ricky Martin.
Total budget?
£36.20.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to Leather Island.
Bergerac, great to see you.
Can't talk, Lovejoy. I'm linseed oiling my man breasts. Gosh, I'm so weather-beaten and handsome and brooding. How are you, man? No, not too close. I'm physically averse to same-gender petting.
It's been a great morning. A lady dropped her purse in the antiques shop and was forced to bend down and pick it up.
Were you at the correct angle to witness the total eclipse that was her ass?
Like two bowling balls in cling film.
You tiny rogue!
Oh, I forgot to tell you. Totally slipped my mind. Some girl's been murdered.
Hmm.
Did she murder herself or did someone help her out? All the signs point to one fact. I don't know. Let me guess. Some silly, young, naive little East Coast slapper slag who got her knickers in a twist, crossed the line, fell in with the wrong crowd, had one too many, couldn't keep her mouth shut and met her maker in the loving arms of a combine harvester. Not far off. The vicar's wife, found down by the butchers with a mark on her. Take a stroll, shall we, via the topless darts tournament at the Windsor Arms.
Walk? Walk to the butchers? Are you gaga, man? It's almost 1/12 of a mile away. No, we'll take the miniature steam train.
Ah, the other side of the island.
Lucek! Lovejoy!
Charlie! Hey, old fella, embrace me roughly, then stand aside whilst I iron out the traces of homoerotic shame from my chinos. How are you, man?
A little worse for wear after that 1/12 of a mile walk. My ticker isn't what it used to be.
Okay, where's the sorry little victim?
Here.
It breaks my heart. When will these women learn that a plunging neckline does not suit someone with a small bust? Terrible. I blame the parents, Jim. I'd never let a friend of mine leave the house wearing baby blue.
What's your gut feeling, Jim?
Positively gastric after that lentil bake at the Fig and Merkin.
No, Jim, what's your diagnosis?
Well, it's obvious, you know, she's got a terminal case of sleepiness. Now, if you'll excuse me, I have a red Jaguar to buff. Say, who's the firm little lady with the see-through dress and the musky scent? That's a bus stop, Lovejoy. Still, she's attracting a queue.
Well, that's very much the end of the show. I'm off to North London now to polish Vanessa Feltz's knickknacks.
She'll enjoy that.
Thanks.
And I'm off to juggle some chicken giblets at the awful festival in Slough. So
thanks very much.
Cab for lovely lady.
Oh, great. If you'd just like to step aside, Sue. I'm here.
Ah, my little anchovy.
Please. We're on air.
Not you, mud flaps. I mean, Susan, the moon-faced beauty with the skin like alabaster.
What? What's going on?
Well, listen, when Cupid draws back his bow, Melanie...
I'm real glad you decided to take a ride home in the limo with me last week, Susan. You made full use of the in-car entertainment, no, my little sesame bun?
Yes,
I don't believe this, Sue. Yeah. You didn't.
I couldn't face the boss again, I'm sorry.
Sue Perkins, you are a...
Sensitive hirsute and generous...
Slag!
All right. I'm sorry, I need a lift home. That's all I can say in my defense.
I don't
care. Sorry. No, it's not my fault.
Hey, girls. You are like a pair of Ukrainian mountain cats fighting over the salami. I take you both home.
Yeah, in your dreams.
Hendon is a long way.
Look, we'll get our things. Please, please, just go.
I love you. Hold me.
Now.
The Mel and Sue Thing was written by and starred Simon Groom. It also featured me, Paul Shahidi. Music was by Brian Clutterbuck and Miko Gedroich. Mel and Sue appear courtesy of Chicken Express Pearly Way, Croydon. It was produced by Elizabeth Priester. All audience members were psychologically harmed during the making of this programme. And now for some wrong things.
Kind and pretty little lovely, can I carry on forever? Aunt! Until you were
Uncle!
Better.
Sorry about that, I should have come in sooner.
To a picnic.
It's the training.
Training.
You learned how to walk like a baboon at Rada, didn't you? Thank you so much.
Don't
patronise me with your pavilion applause from lords. We shall bring our own when it comes to pulling it out of a can.
There now follows a discussion about Sweet Fanny Adams by Profession...
Training. What was it, a whole year on dialect?
Yes.
No, it was 2 years on Gibbons.
Two on Gibbons.
Two on Gibbons.
Yes.
One on dialect.
Yeah.
You can't do English, but his Russian is unreal.
Let's workshop it through. Come on. Do some trust games. Come on.
Fine.
You're brave.
I like that.
I tell you what, I found your inner child there.
I'll put it away now.
Yes.
Thatcher, my milk snatcher, my perfect steely Margot.
I want to show you my arsenal of weapons in... This voice is terrible. I'm so sorry.
From a raffia workshop at the Gwent Remand Centre with their parole officer Carol, it's Mel and Sue!
Good evening, I'm Mel.
Good evening, I'm Sue.
And I'm Carol.
And welcome to this, our last show of the series.
Ah, I know.
Getting on our side.
This sounds like the audience from Pets Win Prizes.
We've been given end-of-term reports by Radio 4. Mine says, Melanie has made good progress. If this carries on, we might even let her touch Libby Purvis.
Oh, happy day. Mine says, Susan has made good progress. Could she stop touching Libby Purvis?
Now, we have been paid, which is good, and here's how I was recompensed for my work on the series.
And here's how Radio 4 financially compensated me. Now, our music man tonight is an actual award winner. Yep, he got third best guinea pig at the Fetchum KB show. It's Cassandra Haggis.
And we have been very lucky to have plucked him from the glittering West End of Salford, Paul Shahidi.
Finally, my daughter, we are here. Gee whiz, Daddy, start spreading the news. Whip crack away, hooray for Hollywood.
One feels liberated to have escaped the clutches of those grubby little debt collectors.
And that horrid manager of Threshers in Solihull. Honestly, what's a £3,000 IOU between close personal treasured friends? In America, we are safe. Hollywood, home of Oscar, home of pornography. Home of Jane Seymour.
Talentless twat. She's had so many Botox injections, her forehead could house the entire cast of Babe, Pig in the City. I bet she's never put on rouge in front of a naked bulb. Fingers clasped around Budgen's own brand, 70% proof.
Now, we must find our B&B. It's run by a fallen star of Broadway. It's called Robert Downey Jr.'s Nook.
Yes.
I worked on Broadway, remember, Mummy? Ealing Broadway. The Mecca Bingo Hall. Did a brave two-hander about congenital obesity.
I remember, darling. So brave!
Such rapture to see their ravaged working-class claws clutch at the air every time I mention two fat ladies.
I am crying at the memory of it, my darling.
So desperate were they to win a porcelain treater to take home and adorn their sad little mantle pieces. Oh, real tears without a glycerin stick.
Thank you.
Oh, look, darling. The Dorothy Trendler Pavilion.
Call this a theatre? Ruddy disgrace. Where are the oversized boxes of matchmakers and Maltesers? Where is the swirly patterned carpet and the fur?
Where's the porter cabin doubling up as a toilet and box office? And look at this. Handprints everywhere, little vandals. Could have waited till the concrete dried, bloody hooligans.
They've even had the gall to leave their names. Judy Garland, Marilyn Monroe, Jeff Stryker.
The man in the beard at the front is in raptures.
Yes.
Won't take long to work out your video collection. Now, it's 9:30 a.m. and Mummy needs a little sharpener. Gaviscon and Coke.
Just the ticket.
In the meantime, Mummy, let us travel to the YMCA in the style of Oscar Wilde.
There is only one thing worse than travelling on foot, and that is not travelling on foot.
Yes.
Very good.
Thank you, thank you.
And now on BBC Radio 4, Dead Ringers.
And now, in association with the Dennis Norden Cock-Up Clinic, the Unistubbs Task Force Against Double Entendre, and the Staffordshire Coprophile Hotline, BBC Radio 4 is proud to present the final instalment of the lost novella of Jane Austen, Sweet Fanny Adams.
And so I, Fanny, being hard of hearing and soft of buttocks, with a jaundiced cheek, calipered limbs, curved spine, pockmarked forehead, withered hands, palsied dugs, and atrophied guts, I've come to stay with my gentle and kind relatives. Today, my dear sweet cuz has trussed my feet with razor wire and stuffed me under the lid of a piano forte. So bored is she by my constant ejaculations.
Cease your garrulous chattenance, you bony-faced Harrigan. Your compliance subordinance is spazzing my cranium.
Indeed, my pretty and kind...
Ugh, enough. Aunt, uncle, Fanny's hurled herself into the pianoforte and is taunting me with her countryness.
What is this ear-blithering ruckus, Harriet, my dear child? Come to my consumptive paps. Has that witless wench been irritating you again?
I hate her. She's boring and stupid and...
Fanny, you feckless little puke pot. Look at the foul, salivating young deformity. Her undiluted oral urinations are meeting my goiters, jellify. Pull her from the pianoforte.
Ow, my punctured pancreas.
My poor angel, Harriet, you must be sorely in need of a diversion from this prattling apish goon bucket.
We will take you to the country fair in Bristol, whereupon we shall laugh at the enormous marrows, thus proving that comedy has little progressed since medieval times.
Ah, marrows! We must faint immediately.
Not you, Fanny! You shall be bound in a pig's membrane until your gallbladder arrests. Then you shall be sent to the ostler, whereupon he shall assail you with a blunt hiking stick till your flanks are as red as a parson's pole.
Take her from here, quick haste, poof speed, great muchly, whereupon I shall belt her in the drafty passage.
Hurrah!
How many more times do we have to tell these people I don't need nasal trimmers by mail order catalogue?
It's you!
What is this brouhaha, you slithering oaf ninny? You're a wandering nonsense man, and take that reverb microphone away from your chops.
Sorry, I'm from the Regency Lottery. I'm delighted to tell Miss Fanny Adams that she has won the jackpot of 8 million shillings!
8 million shillings? We must faint immediately. Fanny, is it too late in the day to say that I've always loved you?
We must celebrate. We must partake of goose fat, gristle, and inferior tarts.
To the Harvester Brasserie on the A406.
Indeed.
Oh, I've never been to a harvester before. I shall wear calico and my finest bodice and ringlets and be the belle of the ball.
Not you, Harriet. You shall be broiled in the tear until your skin flakes like a leper's backside. Come, my favourite limping and now rich niece, Fanny. Let us partake of the mixed grill of the harvester.
Oh, hello, my dear.
Oh, hello, dearie. You all right?
Yeah? Tell you what, I've got a bit of a spring in my step, and it's not owing to my spongy mules.
Oh, no. Well, you do look quite nippet there. You look like a nice brisket of mutton that's had a wreck of lamb makeover.
I tell you what, my dear, I've just had a smashing piece of news.
Well, is there a special offer on spreads down at the Bronsbury Market? Like
No, it's not that. This piece of news is about that pair what should be in Crafts that's on the radio, Mel and Sue. This is their last show.
Oh, well, get the band thing out. I tell you what, I won't be shaking my booty as much since Tommy Trinder was in town.
No. I tell you what... Let's book the Chippendales. I fancy a bit of cockle and muscle.
Ain't it nice to have a Joanna working underneath us, eh? Thanks, Joanna.
Kick it, Baldy.
Thank God the series is over. Thank heavens the whole thing's through. It's been an hell of a palaver. This thing with Mel and Sue. We've heard a lot of malarkey,
we've had enough of their lip. I've found Sue very sulky, and Mel's a tad insipid. Thank God the series is over. Let's hope it don't come back. It's been an hell of a palaver. I hope they both get the sack. I felt it around 6:30. I had nowhere to run and hide. Their mediocrity, it made me feel dirty, sir. They made my innards subside. Thank God the series is over. Our radio is free of crud. It's been an hell of a palaver. I had to bring back Roy Hudd. I'll start enjoying me Thursday. Relief, I will feel it not off. I'll put on me round the horn records. And finally we'll have a laugh. The series is over. For comedy it was mistook. It's been an hell of a palaver. I'll tell you who's funnier. That nice Sue Cook.
And now on Radio 4, Songs of Praise.
You are brilliant.
You are super.
You are excellent.
Gosh, you're handsome.
Fair me, my darling millionaire. Are you ready? There are pressmen here who wish to draw a lithograph of you for Heat magazine.
Prudence, our Fanny has struck gold. We shall sell sensational serializations in the Daily Sketch. Hogarth will come and do etchings of her. Finally, we shall get that table at the Ivy.
Good morrow, Aunt Uncle.
What is that nose-curling stench? Have otters taken lodging in the wainscot?
No, it is that most Mardian, malevolent fannock japerer, Harriet. She is a most assured little slut.
But I'm your niecey. I'm elegant and wholesome and beloved.
Silence, you supper-eating niecey little fatterbug, else I shall trolley you to the apothecary, whereupon you shall be festooned with leeches and bled till Michaelmas Eve.
And so I, Harriet, a pretty, blonde, vivacious, adorable, intelligent young woman, carved from the rock of perfection with a modest ego and unerring interest in gentlemen's breeches, came to be ignored by my own family.
Dear Curse, I am off to eat some quail's eggs with the Marquess of Bath. Would you care to join me?
Cease with your gob-offal. I'm nauseous to me colon with your indiscriminate kindness. Ha-ha! I have a plan. Fanny, might I look at your lottery billet?
Why, indeed, my infallible and superior Curse.
Thank you, Madame Dancebont. I shall keep it safe for you in my locket.
Thank you, Curse. I could not ask for a truer friend in all of life.
Now, Fanny, the gentleman is here to present you with your winnings.
Finally, I shall have a store card at Fortnum's and be able to Botox my jowls out of all existence.
Fanny, may I say how radiant and glossy your calipers look in the midday sun?
Oh, Uncle, your sweetness is so overwhelming. I'm so fortunate.
Come now, present your billet to the man and then let us cash in. Then let us carry on our loving family life as normal.
But I do not have it, Uncle.
What do you mean, you sullen mouth gaper?
I have it! It's my billet! I won the lottery, and horrid Fanny stole the ticket from me.
But no, I...
Fanny, come here at once. You have an appointment with the end of my boot.
You deceitful, argumentative gobble-chops. I shall coat you in hot wax till your skin bubbles like a plum tartlet. Then we shall dip you in cow swill and leave you to marinate till St. Swithin's Day.
Ugh, take it away. Her poverty is frightening me.
Nothing for it. Winch her up to the barn roof, then slam dunk the backwards medal pup.
Ow, my distended pubis.
Come, my darling Harriet, gather your millions and let us away to France.
Indeed, where we shall buy cheap wine and be dismayed by the state of the toilets.
Not you,
you Fanny.
You shall be flayed with 1,000 bull's tails and left bleeding in a privet hedge.
Hurrah, we are rich.
And so thus I was left alone with nothing, until finally I was adopted by another family. who, remarking on my lack of everything, called me Sweet Fanny Adams.
And now we go live to Winchester Cathedral for Jane Austen's response to Sweet Fanny Adams.
Way to go, I'm Emma Dine.
All right, I'm Bo Ring.
I once got a photograph coming out of China White's nightclub wearing nothing but a pair of flesh-coloured pop socks.
And I was all in the papers when I had a fling with Ulrika Johnson's gardener's best mate's acupuncturist.
Which makes us presenters.
All right, way to go.
Now listen, because we're going to present something right now.
Yeah.
Which means that I'm going to stick my lallies right out in this crop top.
And I'm going to flick my hair.
Yeah.
Right. This new soap is called something foreign.
Bit like one of them Cornish pasty things.
Here it is. Hang on, let me look at my notes.
What does it say?
It's Huevos Rancheros.
Way to go.
Yeah.
Rita Conchita, estás muy fanciábilos. Gracias, mes.
Juan Esteban, mis labias son tuos con todos mi cor.
¡No! Juan Esteban, Rita, tú seas mías maritos, chopos nachos tuos, slices cojones.
Gloria, perdones, mes.
No, Rita, tú seas Edwina Curias. Slaga, slaga. Juan Esteban, de partes.
Ma gloria, muchacha, Conchita, isla bonita.
De partes.
Gloria, non lagrimadas, Conchita. Mascara, runos, chicos.
Ah, no. Es mascara, non drip.
Ah. Non drip, bonita.
Sí. En este ben mío, mi aritos, non tu ameritos, si filtis laberos.
No, Gloria, credimi. Juan Esteban es impotente, in sac.
Sí, un like camsteros.
Gloria, Rita, si muchos bonitas.
Tu prestos son space opers.
Oh, Gloria.
Oh, Rita.
Oh, Gloria.
Gloria.
Oh, Juan Esteban.
Mi marita es lesbica. No, no, estos argentinos no es posibles. Mia Gloria Esteban, mia cuores brocos. Slagos.
Chandeleros y chateros.
Tablos cracos.
Gloria.
No, Juan Esteban, cookiamos grande barbecuos para te.
Sí, barbecuos gauchos. Three-way.
Sí.
Huevos Rancheros, flagshipos programos Buenos Aires, veniendo prontos a Radio 4.
BBC Radio 4 now presents The League of Gentlemen.
Earl of Leicester 3.
Duke of Newcastle 2.
The tiniest island in the Bristol Channel, ignored by map makers.
Pinprick.
Population 4, although Mrs. Marshall's feeling randy.
Goat.
One Persian rug dealer, one crazy golf course, and the UK's largest sex museum.
Handcuffs.
Jim Bergerac, a detective with a face as orange as a Christmas satsuma.
Judith Chalmers.
Lovejoy, an antiques dealer with a special way with women.
Eunuch.
Is this the very last ever episode?
It depends on Radio 4.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to Leather Island.
Jim!
Lovejoy! Sorry, man, I was just depilating my calves. Nothing like the removal of man fur to make you feel more streamlined. What's the score?
There's been a death.
Anyone hurt?
Not unless you count the dead woman.
Talk me through it. A slight case of death or something more serious?
I was looking to you, Jim, for the answer on that one. Lady found beaten by a Staffordshire ladle circa 1944.
Probably some needle junkie with a sex-mad pair of crazy thighs who danced with the devil, played poker with Beelzebub, and then went on to share half a shandy with the Grim Reaper.
God, you're good, Jim.
I've been married 11 times. There's nothing I don't know about women. Except how to keep them. What was her name?
Jane Doe.
What with a name like that, she was destined to end up pulseless. Where is she?
She was found outside the betting shop, Jim. 3 pints short of a full vascular system.
The betting shop? But that's almost 400 yards away. Over the other side of the island. These murdered fillies certainly know how to try my patience.
Take a stroll over, shall we, Jim?
Can't we take the boat?
Done it.
The decommissioned submarine.
Episode 4.
The chopper, the car, the hovercraft, a Harrier jump jet.
Done them all!
Damn it! I'm actually going to have to walk to the other side of the island.
Yep. Brace yourself, Jim. Here goes. Here we are. The other side of Leather Island.
Give me a chance to get my breath back, will you?
Lovejoy! Bergerac!
Charlie!
Run your fingers through my luxuriant chest hair, then slap me soundly across the face for entertaining those thoughts again.
Let me adjust my girdle, then we can slap palms. How are you, man?
I'm fit to drop after my walk to the other side of the island. Feels like I've run a marathon.
How's the corpse? Still dead, or is she fighting back?
I don't know. Better ask the expert. Jim, is she dead?
Either that, or she's just broken the UK breath-holding championships.
I think it was an auto-erotic asphyxiation sex game that went horribly wrong.
No, I think she was bored. And she gave up on life by making her own heart stop.
Another case solved!
Yeah.
Love to stay, but I'm off to a soggy biscuit tournament at the old Pig and Whistle. Won't be a lot of fun since there's only the three of us left behind on the island, but I'll give it my best shot. Let's hope I've got the energy to make it back to the...
Charlie, I'd love to give you the kiss of life, old friend, but all male mouth-on-mouth action brings back painful memories of that go-go bar in Utrecht. My counselor tells me I must always remain vigilant in the ward against same-sex attraction.
I understand, Jim.
Jim, he's trying to mouth something. Charlie, a little tip, old-timer. We could hear you a lot better if you spoke up and stopped having that heart attack.
Come on.
Women... they're all slags.
Trust Charlie to be so profound. Right up to the bitter end. Leave him there with his trousers down and his blue tongue pointing skywards. He would have wanted it that way.
Say, who's that thin, elegant waif in the stripy T-shirt winking at me?
That's a pelican crossing, Lovejoy.
Still, she's battery-operated, isn't she?
Well, that is the end of the show, ladies and gents.
Sadly. Actually, usually our... I know. But obviously our minicab driver's usually here to pick us up. I don't know what's happened to him today. I don't know.
And now on Front Row, we sift through the detritus that was the Mel and Sue show and wonder why. Why were these women allowed to rampage through the hallowed airwaves of Radio 4? Why didn't somebody stop them? And why do they keep phoning my home number late at night? Thankfully, from the cess-filled mediocrity, there did rise one true star. Their minicab driver, whose brief interjections raised the level of the show and brought him the notoriety he deserves. So please welcome, from the Boz Cabs office in Harleston, my new co-presenter on Front Row and a future star of Radio 4, Borislav Amorovich.
Thank you, Mark. I like the Front Row very much, especially Francine Stock. If I was her boyfriend, I'd give her Turkish delight on a daily basis. I prefer back row, I gotta say. It's darker, and if you spill your baklava, it makes interesting evening, no?
Sorry to interrupt.
Hello, sorry, Borislav. Sorry to interrupt the show. Do you remember us?
I'm expecting your child in about 8 months' time.
you and I were arranged to be married next month at your brother's fun fair.
No, your mouths are familiar, but I'm sorry, I'm very busy here with Mark.
You gave us a lift home every week.
Yeah, in your burnt-out Allegro?
I was sick once because the smelly tree was so strong.
You must remember, I got out my hazard triangle at Willie Edge Services.
No. Sorry, girls. Ring my agent. Anyway, Mark, let's talk about this new Swedish girly film.
Right. Well, bye then, Borislav.
Yeah, bye, Borislav.
Bye, audience, I suppose.
Bye, Sue. Bye, Sue.
Bye, Mel.
Good luck with that camel-beating course.
Thanks. It's a panel-beating course.
Sorry.
Good luck with the work on the North Circular. I know it's hard for punters to stop on the gyratory system, but all the best.
Cheers. Goodbye. On foot then, yeah?
I guess so.
Goodbye.
Goodbye.
The Mel and Sue Thing was written by and starred Paul Shahidi and Miko Gedroych. The memorable moments were provided by Paul Shahidi and Miko Gedroych. The two people who will go on to have careers after this series will be Paul Shahidi and Miko Gedroych. The show was produced by Little Lil Freestow.
And now for some wrong things.
Bingo Hall, or even Bingo Hall.
Yes.
Although Bingo Hall has a lovely ring to it.
Yes,
why
it
someone
does.
Hasn't come up with Bingo, the new game for people with dyslexia.
Yes.
And who are nonagenarians, I don't know.
Crushing on, my darling.
Let's start
crushing
again.
On, yes.
I worked on Broadway, remember, Mummy? Ealing Broadway.
They didn't laugh as loudly. Didn't go down as well.
One man in the front row clasped his genitals and lolled his head backwards as if to say, you know. And for that, I shall take you home to my... Report, George. Crying is masking my line.
Sorry, darling.
Cry more discreetly, you dreadful gammon.
Finally, we shall get that table at the Ivy.
Now we have to stop because Mel
sorry.
Can't get her. No.
Okay,
that's good. You did the whole lot to them.
Okay. I'll put on me round the horn records and I'll take a course in singing.